Good morning, Harvest. Let's stand. Let's be ready to sing this morning. Father, we come into your house, we come into your presence as a people, and we come ready to worship you. We're coming this morning full of faith and belief that you're the God who you say you are, and that you're gonna do the things that you said you were gonna do. And so this morning, we come with hope and trust and faith. We come with our need, we come with hurt, we come with all of us, we come with the whole self, and we just bring it to you, Lord, as an offering. But God, this morning, more than anything, we just acknowledge who you are, that you're the God who sits on the throne, that you're over all, and so because of that, we know that we can come in confidence, we can worship you this morning, and so let's do that together this morning, people.
We have every confidence that he's faithful. Yes, our testimony is the living proof. And if you doubt the evidence that he's able, open your eyes, people, get ready. Just build an altar, trench it. No one like him. He holds all power. This is our God. He makes a mountain move with just a whisper. He calls the dead to walk out of a grave. Let the ones that he redeemed lift up a banner. Now is the time, people, get ready. Just build an altar, trench it in water. Stand back and wonder, he'll start a fight. Nothing can stop him, there's no
Nothing can stop him. Oh, there's no one.
have just made your way in, which is good morning, welcome. It's good to gather together. I'm out of breath. Oh man, 9 a.m. Oh, it's good to be together, to come and lift high the name of Jesus, to come and worship his holy name, to remember the things that our God has done throughout history, and trust and believe in faith that he's gonna work today and work tomorrow. What a beautiful thing that we come together and encourage one another in our faith too. So today we're talking, Tommy's bringing the word today, and we're talking about identity. And I won't start preaching, but there is so much that the world wants to say about our identity. But God has said so much about us. He has spoken truth over who we are. And so this morning, we're gonna read this out together, and we're gonna read this loud, and we're gonna declare the truth of God's word, of what he says that we are. So it's on the screen. Let's read this together, and let's read this with strength. Let's read this over one another as we also read it over ourselves this morning. Here we go. For you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Come on, I want to hear you. So once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. And so we thank you, Lord, that we are yours. We're co-heirs with Christ. We are called your children of God. And so we just thank you, God, for who you have called us to be. And so who we are worships you then back. We love you, God. Thank you. Amen.
He died.
people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. For once you were not a people, but now you are. For once you were not a people, but now you are. And once you have not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that we are your chosen people. So we sing this out together.
Well, come on, church, lift your voice all across this room. Declare this over yourself. Come on, let your song rise today. lying in. Oh, come on. Let's blow the roof off with this place with praise to the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. We sing, come on, my soul. Oh, come on, my. Oh, lift up your song. Oh, you got a lion in. Oh, get up and praise the Lord. Oh, come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. Oh, you got a lion inside those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Oh, my soul. Up our hands, not only as a sign of giving honor and glory to Him, but as a sign of complete surrender to Him, saying, God, my life is yours, and I give it to you again and again and again. In Ephesians 5, verse 1 through 2, it says, therefore, be imitators of God as dearly loved children, and walk in His love as Christ also loved us and gave Himself for us, a sacrificial and fragrant offering to God. As we continue in our time of worship through our time of giving today, that I want us to be a church that lives this verse out, that as Christ gave Himself for us, that we would imitate that, that we would be a reminder that we are actually called to be living sacrifices, holy and pleasing and acceptable to God, that our life is not our own, but it's all His, that all I am and all I have is His, that we can, as we give today, that we would do it with that posture of complete surrender, saying, God, here's what I have to give. It may be a little, it may be a lot, whatever it is, I come with complete surrender, saying, God, I know you can do more with this than I could ever have, so I surrender it to you. The ways to give will be on your screen. You can scan the QR code, you can give online, give through the app, so many different ways that we can give. But as we give today, let us not forget His sacrifice. That He paid the price that we deserved. He made a way when there was no way. We were brought from death and into life. And in response, children of God, we say, God, my life is an offering to you. God, we give you everything we have to you. So Jesus, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for the cross. We thank you that you took the punishment that we deserved, that we can have new life today. And we pray in this moment, Lord, that as we give, as we sow into what you're doing in this house, Lord, that your kingdom would advance like never before, that the gospel will not only flourish in this church, but in this city, in our nation, and the nations of the earth, God. We give you our time. We praise you.
We honor you. We say, come and have your way. We love you, and in Jesus' name, amen. Let's continue worshiping.
It's always your kindness, Lord. It's always your kindness, Lord, that leads to repentance and the healing I've witnessed. It's always your kindness, Lord. It's only your mercy,
to you, my
Are so far from you. You are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You have our allegiance. You have our devotion. We love you, Lord. And it is just so beautiful to sing your name this morning. We love you. I pray this in your name. Amen. Amen. You guys can have a seat.
Good morning, everybody. It's really good to start our week worshiping the Lord together, and we have a really cool privilege in this service and in the next service of having some parents come and bring their children to be dedicated to the Lord. Now, I can tell you as a dad, my wife and I, if Diana and I had a way that we could do something that would guarantee our kids would be followers of Jesus, we would have done it. But that actually is not ours to choose. That's the child's to choose, right? And so these parents, just want to be really clear, there aren't any kids getting saved today. That's a personal decision for the child when they come to that place. But what is happening is a mom and a dad are bringing these kids and saying, we need the Lord's help to raise them in a way that they would know the love of Christ, that they would, we pray, turn to Him at the youngest possible age. And frankly, we need each other to do it. So we've got the privilege as a church family here of just praying with them as they dedicate their children to the Lord. So I'm going to start here and ask Ariel, would you just introduce your family to us and tell us who's here?
Well, hi, good morning. My name is Ariel, and this is my husband, Ben, and our daughter, Aria, and our son, Klaus.
Fantastic. And Klaus is getting dedicated to the Lord today, as you have done with your daughter previously. And you guys chose a scripture for this moment. So would you read it for us, Ben?
Yes, thank you. We chose Psalm 78, verses 2 through 7. I will open my mouth in parable. I will utter dark sayings from of old, things that we have heard and known that our fathers have told us. We will not hide them from their children. But tell them to the coming generation the glorious deeds of the Lord and His might and His wonders that He has done. He established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, which He commanded our fathers to teach us, to teach to their children, and that the next generation might know them, the children yet unborn, and arise and tell them to their children, so that they should set their hope in God, and not forget the works of God, but keep His commandments.
I love it. Isn't that our prayer? That our kids would set their hope on the Lord. And we're going to pray in just a moment for your family and for Klaus. We're excited for you guys. And I'm going to step in between you right here. And we've got another wonderful family. And why don't you just introduce yourself to us?
Hi, I'm Brittany. This is my husband, Matt, and our children, Walter and Doris.
Wonderful. No boredom at your house either, huh? No. And you guys also chose a scripture for your kids, and would you read that for us?
You'll have to excuse me. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again in living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you by God's power, and being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time.
That's awesome. Boy, we just get to see a visual of what it takes, right? To have these kids and to love them and nurture them. And in this moment, we're going to pray for them. And I love that you guys have your eyes on the Lord Jesus Christ. He is your hope and he is their hope. And so let's all pray together for these families and for these kids. And if you want to pray by faith, why don't you just even lift up a hand towards them as we pray and dedicate these kids to the Lord. Heavenly Father, what a beautiful thing. What a beautiful thing to see your plan of a man and a woman joining their life together. What an amazing thing to recognize that children are a gift from the Lord. And so, Lord, for these fathers, I pray that you would give them great wisdom and strength and humility to follow Jesus with their whole heart. For moms, Lord, would you give them energy and joy and peace today and all days? Lord, these parents are giving themselves to raise these kids. Most of all, we pray for the children that their eyes would be turned to Jesus Christ. They would understand their need of a Savior. They would understand there is a Savior, and that they would put their trust in Christ alone at the earliest possible opportunity. Lord, we pray they walk with you as soon as possible and for a lifetime. And Lord, as a church family, help us to support, help us to pray, help us to encourage and cheer and help any way we can. We love you, Lord. Have your way in these sweet kids, we pray, in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen, amen. Congratulations, guys. Why don't you encourage them? I love that. That's great. That's great. That's cool. I like that a lot. That's wonderful. Well, welcome to everybody. My name is Dave. I'm one of the pastors here, and just want to connect on a couple of things this morning. We thought, first of all, today we would ask all of our visitors to just line up on stage like we did with... No. You're like, no, don't do it. No, we won't do it. We're not going to single you out. We don't want to make it weird, but we do want to welcome you. So if this is your first time or if you come a couple of times, welcome. We're glad you're here. We'd love to meet you. Right after the service, there's a welcome table in the lobby. I'm going to go out there. Would love to say hi before you go today. For everybody, we like to connect. We like to know you're here. We like to pray for you. So that happens through the Connect card. If you're looking for a piece of paper, you won't find it because it's all digital. It's 2023, you know. So the Connect card, there's QR codes on the back of the chairs. You can use your phone to go there. There's also the app. I would actually really encourage the app, Harvest Bible Chapel Chicago. Lots of stuff there. But one of the best things is when you use the Connect card, you can ask for prayer, or you can say, praise the Lord, he answered prayer. And our staff prays through those every week. We'd love to pray for you. So please, each time you're here, let us know and if we can be praying for you. We are Harvest Bible Chapel, so the Bible is a big deal. It is the standard. It is our foundation. And so we're going to, as we always do, encourage you to study the Word. But there's an opportunity coming to do this with others, and it's our Romans Bible study. So on our campus, starting the week of September 11th, this is both for men or for women, we're going to start a Romans study. Now, you can study the Word on your own, and I hope you do. But there's something great about doing it with others in community where you can talk and you can pray and you can apply. Romans has some of the deepest theology you'll find. It also has some of the most practical, personal application. And together, we're going to start that study September 11th. If you've been looking for a place to connect or grow, that would be a perfect place for you. So get the information and come and join us for that. We have... Today, because it's the first week in the month, we're going to have a special offering. Now, we already talked about our regular giving, and that's something that's between you and the Lord. It's whenever he would lead you to do that. Once a month, we're going to do a special offering for a specific purpose. And today, the special offering is for our benevolence ministry and the compassion ministry. So the simplest way to say that is benevolence is caring for our church family. Crisis times, difficult times, we got to help each other. We got to bear each other's burdens. compassion is outside of our church family. Who else can we bless? That's the Hope Center. That's a lot of other things we do. So at the end of the service, the ushers will be at the doors, and if you feel compelled to give to the special offering, you can do that today. All of that goes to benevolence and compassion. It's separate from our normal offering. But why? Well, this is what we read in the Gospels. For I was hungry, Jesus said, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and visit you? And the king will answer them, truly, I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers, you did it to me. That's what our Lord Jesus Christ has to say about compassion for others. And so that's why we give the opportunity, and we're going to commit that offering in this whole service to the Lord in prayer right now. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have not left us alone, and you have not left us without hope, and you have not left us without instruction, that you lead us, that you guide us, that you tell us what's on your heart. Part of that, Lord, is a kindness, a generosity, a clothing, a feeding, a welcoming of those who are in need. So Lord, you don't actually need us to do that, but you give us the privilege of being a part of doing that. So we just commit this special offering to you, and we pray that it would reach the people you want reached in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, now we lean into your word, we lean into your truth, we receive it from you today. Help us to have tender hearts, to listen closely to your heart today. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, in just a moment, we're going to get into our message for today, and but I want to give you a moment to greet somebody. I want to see a friendly church, so look, get up and look around and say, hey, I'm really glad you came to church today, all right? Take a moment right now and do that.
Good morning, church. It's good to see you, and welcome to our campuses that are joining us right now in Crystal Lake and Elgin and the North Shore. We love you guys, and I hope that you've been having a great summer. Slammed probably right now with going back to school and the busyness of the season, but it's good to be in the house of the Lord this morning, isn't it? Amen. If you're new, my name's Tommy Creutz. I serve as the campus pastor of our Crystal Lake Church, and also on our teaching team, and it is a pleasure to be with you guys today, bringing God's Word, and we're going to jump right into it. Is that all right with you? Is that good? Okay. We are going through a series called Ask Anything, and we've been going through this over the summer, and we have asked you to ask us some of the questions that you might have about life and the Bible and culture, and we've been taking those questions, and we've been taking the most frequently asked questions and doing sermons on them throughout the summer. And so today is no different than that. We're going to be doing that this morning, but we're going to be doing that with probably the most asked question that we received. And that question is on gender identity. So the title of the message is Identity Crisis. Identity Crisis. This is a topic that is near to my heart. I've had hundreds of discussions over the past decade with students who have been struggling in this area. I've spoken with a former student who transitioned completely to the opposite gender. I've had former students go off to college and come back and identify as non-binary. I have seen many embrace and affirm this ideology, so it is a topic that is very near to my heart. So what I want to do is I want to start off with some statistics, just to kind of bring us all up to speed on what it is exactly that we're talking about, and give us a little bit of more information. And so here's some stats. Roughly 1.6% of American adults identify as transgender or non-binary. I want to maybe give you some definitions for that right there. Transgender is being a person who feels as if their gender identity does not match the one they were given at birth. And non-binary is a person who feels that their gender identity is neither male or female. So roughly 1.6% of American adults identify as trans or non-binary. The percentage in young people is actually much higher. It's 5% between the ages of 13 and 29. And that is 2% who identify as trans, 3% as non-binary. To give us maybe another number for that, that's 1 in 20, 13 through 29-year-olds. Another study measured how many adult Americans knew a trans or non-binary person. 44% said they knew a trans person. 20% said they knew someone who was non-binary. Of those trans people, 27% of adults said that the trans person was a friend, 13% a coworker, 10% a family member, and 9% said that that person was younger than 18. So just to give us a little statistics and numbers to kind of place around this topic that we're talking about, because I would imagine probably in our church, you've heard of this. Have you heard of it? Have you heard this topic going around? What we also find is that we have seen a 400% increase in news coverage about this ideology. And that is not even including and accounting for the rise of this topic in social media, which is widespread. Hundreds of bills on this subject, both for and against, have been drafted to try and become law. Policies in schools across the country have been put in place affirming this ideology. Needless to say, it has become a hot button issue in our culture. You agree? Hot button issue. So what is the Christian to do? How do we think about this? How do we engage with this as Christians? What is the solution to this, if any, at all? What do we do? How do we live in this world? So here's where we start. It's where we always start, church. We set the foundation. We set the foundation. As a Christian, our first move is to see what God's word tells us about this area. And no matter what the cultural issue or whatever the question is, we always start here because we can feel a lot of ways and we can think a lot of ways. And to be honest, the way that I feel and think about this doesn't really matter that much. What really matters is what God's word has to say about this in our life. So what does God's word tell us? Does God's word speak specifically to it? And if not, are there principles in God's word that we can grab that can help us navigate through this issue? So let's look at it together. We're going to start in the best place that we can, in the beginning. Genesis 1, you're going to need your Bible. Open it up. First chapter, Genesis 1. We're going to be in verse 26. Here's what it says. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over the livestock and over all the creature, all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. I want to point us to two really important truths in Genesis 1 that we need to grab a hold of. Those two truths, the first one is that God assigns value to mankind. He assigns value to mankind. Do you see it? Do you see it here in Genesis 1? God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created man. Rapid repetition. God is trying to grab our attention with this so that we understand this truth, that we have been made in the image of God. He has given us an identity as image bearers of God, the Creator. And what does it mean to be made in God's image? Well, it means that we have been given minds to think and emotions to feel and wills to make decision and an inner spiritual nature that enables us to know and worship God. Listen, animals and trees don't get that. We do. Because God made us uniquely in creation and he put his image on us and we are image bearers of the Creator. And so we have value because we are made in God's image. It is what determines our value. God, because he created you. You are not an accident. We are not a product of nature. You have been fashioned by God. Psalms 139 tells us that you and I were fearfully and wonderfully made. So God assigns value. The second thing that we see is that God gives us identity. We saw the first one, that he made us in his image. Then he gets specific. He made us male and female. He created us male and female. Specific identities that God, the Creator, gave his creature for us to live in. And then at the end of the chapter, verse 31, and God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. It was very good. Making man in his own image after his likeness and creating them male and female, it was very, very good. This is God's divine design. And it is a beautiful design, and it is very good. Problem is that when we depart from God's divine design, when we say that what God made isn't good or isn't good enough for me, real pain starts to happen. In fact, that's what we see two chapters later in Genesis 3, the fall of mankind. Mankind was deceived by the serpent, and he departed from God's design and sinned against God. And as a result, it fractured our world, and it has never been the same since. And so it is no wonder that we have an identity problem, because sin and corruption, when it entered into the world through sin, it seeks to always destroy the design of God. The original design of God, it seeks to deceive, it seeks to distort, it seeks to destroy that design. So no wonder we have an identity problem in our world and have always had an identity problem in our world. But when the world looks at a passage like this, they have some objections. What they would say and what they do say about this passage is Genesis 1:27, God created them male and female. Well, that's not talking about gender. That's talking about biological sex. Now, I think that you could stay in Genesis 1:27 and argue I think you can argue it till the cows come home, that no, this was God's original intended design, that he created mankind, male and female, and he intended them to live in the identities that he created for them. So I think you can argue that from Genesis 1, but let's take a look at other verses in Scripture and see the consistency of Scripture and action. In fact, one of the other places that we see this consistency is through the sexual ethic that God gives man and woman. In Romans 1:26 and 27, for this reason, God gave them up to dishonorable passions, for their women exchanged natural relations, these are important words, for those that are contrary to nature. And the men likewise gave up natural relations with women and were consumed with passion for one another, man committing shameless acts with men and receiving in themselves the due penalty for their error. Do you see it? Male and female. In the sexual ethic, there is a consistent gendered behavior with the identity that God has placed on them in creation. It is consistent. Deuteronomy 22:5, a woman shall not wear a man's garment, nor shall a man put on a woman's cloak, for whoever does these things is an abomination to the Lord your God. This word, by the way, isn't some raising up of this sin to some pedestal level. It is a word for sin. There's a lot of abominations in the Old Testament and the Mosaic law. We shouldn't get hyperfixated on that. But do you see, again, consistent with the creation identity, consistent gendered behavior with the identity God has placed in creation. And so hopefully this is helpful and clear on the matter. I think it's very clear on what God says about sex and gender. The identities that he has created us in. But what about the ideology that exists around this conversation? What about the ideology, right? Have you heard this phrase before? I must do everything to be my true self. It's a phrase you've probably heard. Do you not want me to be true to myself? Do you not want me to find my true self? Do you not want me to live out my authentic self? That sounds really nice, right? Yeah, like live out yourself, like be true to yourself. But what does God's word have to say about that? In fact, what does Jesus have to say about that specifically? Matthew 16:24, then Jesus told his disciples, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Jesus' call to all people is to deny themselves and come after him. Not to live out our true self, but to deny ourselves and follow him. Why? Because our true self is not found in a self-identity in the world. It is only found in Christ. I just want to take a moment. And I have to believe that in a church our size, that there are some maybe in this room who are listening right now who are struggling with identity, struggling with gender identity. Can I just tell you that God loves you? That when we're talking about creation and we see that we are image bearers of God, that's not just the people in our church, that is people everywhere. Every person has been made in the image of God. And you have value, and you are loved by God, and you are welcome here. And Jesus loves you. God loves you so much that he sent his son Jesus to die for you so that you don't need to find your identity in the world, in the confusing world, but you can find your identity in him. Romans 12:2 says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. And so here's where we find ourselves. We find ourselves at odds with culture. Kevin DeYoung actually puts this really well. He calls it the hard and simple. And he talks about culture and he talks about Christianity and Christians. For culture, it is hard to identify identity because identity is infinitely up to the individual. It is whatever the individual seeks to identify as. And so there is no way to truly pinpoint an identity or identifier for identity because it is always changing based on different experiences and different people and different self-identifications. And so it is hard to identify identity for culture, but it is simple to relate. Affirmation only, right? Celebrate self-identity. Love actually equals celebration and affirmation of my self-identity. So hard to identify identity, simple to relate. And then there's where we find ourselves. We are opposite of this. We actually find it simple to identify identity. Male and female, this is what God's word says, and it is consistent all the way throughout. It makes no variance. There is no continuum in God's word. It is male and female lived out in those identities. And so it is simple for us but it is very hard to relate. Knowing exactly how to encourage someone to see the world and themselves rightly, how precisely does speaking truth and love proceed from that? So we set the foundation. Let's go after that hard part. How do we relate? How do we engage? Here's the second thing. Engage practically. Engage practically. In fact, most of the questions that we received on this topic were questions like this. How do we engage? What is the Christian ethic? How do we act as Christians in this area with other people? What does that look like? And so first, what I want to do is I want to bring us to Scripture and to see an example of engaging in culture and some principles that we can put into practice. And then I want to bring us to some specific cultural problems, okay? So we're going to be in Acts 17, 22 through 34. Acts 17, 22 through 34. And what we're going to see here is Paul. And Paul is speaking to the people of the culture. All right, he's brought onto this this hill called Mars Hill, and he's brought into this place called the Areopagus. And in this place are the leaders of culture, philosophers and judges and deep thinkers and influential people of the day. And they are gathered together to listen and debate and to bring new ideas together to discuss. And so what we see in Acts 17 is actually Paul is going to use a framework that some have called yes, yet, so. If you're taking notes, write that down. Yes, yet, so. He uses this framework as he talks to these people, and we're going to see it right here. Acts 17, 22 through 34. So Paul, standing in the midst of the Areopagus, said, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious." This is Paul. This is Paul's yes. This is an affirmation, a positive affirmation of something true, of the men of Athens. "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious. For as I passed along and observed the objects of your worship, I found also an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God.'" Paul is affirming the men of Athens. "I see that you are religious. You're searching. In fact, you're so religious and searching so much that you have even placed an altar to an unknown God, just in case you left any out. You didn't want to leave any gods out, so you put this one here." So this is Paul affirming, bringing yes to. Then he moves into the yet. Now this is the truth statement. Affirmation, true affirmation, then into the truth statement. "What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you." Here comes the truth. "The God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by man, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mankind life and breath and everything, and he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined allotted periods and the boundaries of their dwelling place, that they should seek God and perhaps feel their way toward him and find him. Yet he is actually not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As even some of your own poets have said, for we are indeed his offspring." That is Paul's yet. I see the positive affirmation that you are religious and searching. Let me bring some truth to that searching, because your searching has come up short. So let me bring some truth. And it is about the God who has made everything, who is not far but is actually near to each one of us, in whom we live and move and have our being. Then he moves to the so. So yes, yet, so. Because of that truth, here's what we need to change in our minds. Being then God's offspring, we ought not to think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of man. Times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. Who's this man? That's Jesus. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him. Who's this him? That's Jesus from the dead. Yes, yet so. He brings Jesus in. This is what we need to change. We need to, because of the truth, we need to repent. Because a day of righteous judgment is coming, but we have assurance in Jesus who was raised from the dead. We actually find out the result of this argument that Paul makes. Now, when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked. That's relatable, Paul. But others said, "We will hear you again about this." So Paul went out from their midst, but some men joined him and believed, among whom also were Dionysius, the Areopagite, and a woman named Damaris, and others with them. So we see three results from Paul's time at Mars Hill. Some mocked, some were interested, "We'll see you again on this matter," and some were saved. Now, there is no power in the framework that Paul is using here, but I think that his framework is helpful. I think it is helpful in helping us bring the gospel to our culture as Paul is bringing the gospel to the culture that he is in. We actually received a question, too, about how can I navigate this issue of gender identity and come out the other side unscathed? You don't, right? Neither does Paul, right? And he is, yes, yet so, he's still mocked. So we don't come out on the other side unscathed, but hopefully this framework is helpful to us to start having a conversation with people. And listen, you might be mocked, but people might be interested to hear more of what you have to say. And maybe some would even come to salvation. And in this framework that Paul is kind of speaking, and I think we're better at the yet and the so, the truth statements, although I would love to see more truth in love. I think we can improve in that area. But I think that the part that we really struggle with in this framework is the yes part, the affirmation, the positive affirmation. How do we affirm like Paul affirms? Some Christians have tried to do this with pronouns. Have you heard maybe some of these arguments about using preferred pronouns? There's two sides in this debate in Christianity. And I want to say there are men and women on both sides of this debate who are wonderful men and women of God. Okay? And so I'm not showing you these to bind your conscience to any one of them. I just want to bring them to you. One of the sides is pronoun hospitality. And this is the argument that we should use people's preferred pronouns, what they choose and want to be called in their pronouns. And this side would argue that that they are meeting the person where they're at. That language, because it's a shared space, that there isn't a problem in doing this. And what it is it's showing charitability and respect. Even though there's disagreement on this matter, there's a respect that is given there and meeting them where they're at. And they use Paul as a authority on this to be all things to all people. And so they use the preferred pronouns. Then you have the other side, which is against the pronoun hospitality, and they believe that you should not do this. That, in fact, using those preferred pronouns is lying to them. It's not being truthful to them, and therefore it would be sin for me to use those because they're not true, and I'm lying to you, and how does that then bring someone to Christ? And so they don't use that, but we've seen some compromise there too of maybe using the name instead of the pronouns, right? It is a large debate. Have you heard this debate? Listen, this is not new. It might seem new. It's new names, but this is a debate that's been happening for decades, decades and decades and decades, because this debate is about the contextualization of the gospel to culture. How much of culture or other religions do we allow to influence the way that we preach the gospel or to live out the life of the church? How much do we adapt to the culture? And the reason that it's a long debate, spanning decades is because it's a really good question. Because we do contextualize the gospel to our culture. But the question is, how far do we take that? And it's a really good question. And there are great Christian men and women on both sides of this debate. I will say, I think that what Paul is doing here in Acts 17 and pronoun hospitality are different. Paul is affirming something that is true of the men of Athens. He is saying, I perceive that you are very religious. That's true. They are. Now, it's not in the correct direction, right? It is not in the best way that they are religious, but they indeed are very religious. And Paul uses that searching and that seeking as a way to present the good news of Jesus Christ to them. And so I think that we should follow Paul's way in affirming in people what is true, right? So let me give you an example of this. Maybe if you're in a conversation with someone on this issue of identity, a way that you could affirm them in something true is, hey, listen, I've listened to your story, and I see that you're really searching and seeking an identity to call your own. Searching to see the world and yourself in the best way that you can. And we're all doing that. We're all trying to find identity in the world. Affirm. True, right? And then we can get into the yet and the so's and the truth statements. There is ways to affirm what is true. And so while I might not agree with pronoun hospitality fully, I do agree with hospitality as the way forward in these topics. In fact, I want to share with you a story of hospitality, and it is the story of a woman named Rosaria Butterfield. I think Pastor Jeff has mentioned this story before, but I think it is just absolutely perfect for us as we're thinking about this. If you don't know Rosaria Butterfield's story, she was a professor of English and women's studies. She was a lesbian woman who was an ally and activist of the LGBTQ agenda and ideology. She would go on to publish an article in a newspaper on religion and on politics, to which she received so much hate mail that she would keep two boxes on her desk, one for hate mail and one for her fans. But then she received a letter from a pastor named Ken Smith. And although in the letter Ken disagreed with her on many things, he was respectful and kind. He invited her actually to dinner with his family. I want to read this verbatim from Rosaria. She says, "With the letter, Ken initiated 2 years of bringing the church to me, a heathen. Oh, I had seen my share of Bible verses on placards at gay pride marches. The Christians who mocked me on Gay Pride Day were happy that I and everyone I loved were going to hell was clear as blue sky. That is not what Ken did. He did not mock. He engaged. So when his letter invited me together for dinner, I accepted. My motives at the time were straightforward. Surely this will be good for my research. Something else happened. Ken and his wife, Floy, and I became friends. They entered my world. They met my friends. We did book exchanges. We talked openly about sexuality and politics. They did not act as if such conversations were polluting them. They did not treat me like a blank slate. When we ate together, Ken prayed in a way I had never heard before. His prayers were intimate, vulnerable. He repented of his sin in front of me. He thanked God for all things. Ken's God was holy and firm, yet full of mercy. Because Ken and Floyd did not invite me to church, I knew it was safe to be friends." She later then started reading her Bible more and more and more, and eventually came to faith in Christ Jesus. And the Lord used Ken and his wife's hospitality that day to change the trajectory of Rosaria's life. Could you imagine if we showed hospitality like Ken and Floyd? If we invited people into our homes and sure, disagreed with them, but respected them, befriended them, instead of sending hate mail through the computer or on social media, what if we were inviting people lovingly into our homes? Being quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to anger. I think one thing that we need to realize is that there are real people behind these issues. Real people. And we don't just speak to the issues, we are speaking to the person. Behind every issue to debate, there is an image bearer to love. What if we did that? Here's the third thing we need to remember: the goal. Remember the goal. So set the foundation, engage practically, remember the goal. Some of us really do think that the goal in all of this is to win the argument, right? To win the cultural arguments. We want our point to be heard and understood and be the predominant winner in the social square. We want to win the argument. But that's not actually the goal. Did you know that? The goal is not to win the argument. Now listen, hear me. We need to have the arguments, okay? Amen? We need to have the arguments. We need to stand up for our faith in the public square. We absolutely do. We need to bring what is true, right, and beautiful according to God's word to the culture. So we need to have the arguments because we need to stand up for our faith. We need to have a defense for our faith. We need to defend against the things that are being said in the culture, right? We need to defend against things like emotional hijacking and choice architecture, right? These are manipulation tactics that are being used in culture right now. We need to defend against those. Choice architecture is giving people a certain set of choices that leads them to a desired outcome, right? So let me give you an example of that. Do you affirm me or do you hate me? You see that that's choice architecture? As if those are the only two choices that exist, thus propagating that affirmation equals love, and if you don't affirm me, you hate me, when in reality we all know that that is just completely not true. You can love someone and not totally affirm them, right? I love my wife. She loves me. We do not affirm everything in each other, okay? In fact, some of the most loving things that we do is we challenge each other, right? We challenge one another in our beliefs and our thoughts about things. Sometimes that's the most loving thing that you can do. So that's choice architecture. There's emotional hijacking is the other one. This is where there's an effort to stir up your emotions so much that you start to lose rational thinking because your emotions are so high. So there's a phrase that's been thrown around in this area. Would you rather have a living son or a dead daughter? Right? Have you heard that phrase before? That's emotional hijacking. That's manipulation. Again, as if those are the only two choices there, but it's to get a rise in emotion. We need to defend against these manipulations that we see in the culture, and we need to speak truth. We need to stand up for our faith. We need to defend against, we need to defend the vulnerable in our culture. We see this right now happening in our world. Children, as young as 3 years old, are transitioning, being given drugs. No long-term studies on these things. In fact, it is very real that our children in this day and age in America are being experimented on. And that is wickedness. And we must defend the vulnerable in our culture. And we need to understand as well that there are many people in the LGBTQ belief that are against that as well. Right? They do not believe that children should transition. They don't. They're against it as well. And so we need to also have some nuance in our thinking and not just lop everyone together into one box and demonize the box and say, you believe this and you think this and you're doing this. We need to take each person as an individual. So we need to have the arguments. But listen to me, the goal isn't winning the argument. Because we've seen some pretty great arguments, haven't we? Very logical arguments, very biblical arguments, very rational arguments, and yet we are still in the place that we are in culture. Why? Because the Bible is true, right? But they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things. People's hearts have been darkened. They've been blinded to the truth of God, to the truth of what is good, right, and beautiful. And so we can't just use arguments because people's hearts are darkened. Instead, just a couple of verses before this one in Romans is Romans 1:16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. Arguments alone will not work, church. We need the good news and the power that comes with it to illuminate the darkened hearts of people. And we need to realize, we must realize that people are not the enemy. People are not the enemy. The enemy is Satan. And he is deceiving their hearts and their minds. And so no matter how good we are at arguments, we can't solve it. So what our goal then is, not to win the argument, our goal as Christians is to bring them to the same thing that Paul brings them to in Mars, at Mars Hill, the Areopagus, the resurrected Christ. Right? Our goal is that we would speak in such a way and act in such a way and engage in such a way that helps others start to explore Christ. That's our goal. Because listen to me, Jesus is more loving, he is more grace-filled, he is more truth-filled, he is more compassionate and hospitable than you ever could be. And the solution to the identity problem is for people to see themselves through the eyes of Jesus, for them to find their identity in him. It is not a problem that you and I can solve. And so our goal isn't to try and win the argument to solve the problem. Our goal is to live and speak and act and engage, to bring people to the point of exploring Jesus, the resurrected Christ, who can solve the problem, who can illuminate the heart. Amen? So let's speak truth and love, church. Let's help others start to explore Jesus. Let's pray. God, we thank you for your word this morning. This is such a confusing topic sometimes in our culture. Lord, thank you for the clarity of your word. Thank you for the consistency of your word. Lord, thank you for placing value on us. Thank you for giving us an identity that could never be taken. Lord, I pray that you would help us to go out into the culture and help others to start exploring your son, Jesus Christ. That we would be people like Ken and Floyd who open up our house, inviting even those who disagree with us in to have a meal and give them respect and share Jesus with them. Help us to be people who have that kind of radical hospitality. We need your help in this, Lord, because tempers can flare and these issues can frustrate. And so, Lord, I pray that you help us to continue to be patient and kind and loving to other image bearers. And help us, Lord, to find ways in which we can bring to them Jesus. Illuminate their hearts, Lord. Help us in this, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand as we respond in worship.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken.
I've been thankful for this series, the Ask Anything. You guys ask good questions. Good job. But the answers are always in God's Word, and the answer ultimately is in His Son, Jesus Christ. And so let's keep seeking Him in all of that. If we can pray for you, we'd love to do that. I want to remind you, you can always put a prayer request anytime during the week in through the Harvest app. Also, this week, there's a list of resources. If you want to listen more, you want to read more, there's a list of resources on identity issues that's going to be connected to the message application guide that comes out at 2 o'clock every week on Sunday. You can go find it if you want to study more and keep thinking about this, all right? So we have the opportunity now to go out on mission to represent Jesus everywhere we go. Let's do that in His strength and for His glory. In Jesus' name, amen.